Hi, everybody. This is a video that's going to be more like speed painty Q&A going on. If you don't want to hear me talk, that's totally fine. You just got to click the mute button and links in the description for some music if you want to listen to it. I kind of made some links to some music I think would fit this video really well. So I will see you later. Well, unless you're listening to me actually talk. Okay, so we're doing a Q&A. I put out a little bit of like, hey, ask me questions on my Tumblr and Twitter and Instagram. So these are kind of the questions that I got. So why don't we just dive right into them? Okay, so which software do you use? Okay, so I'm gonna put a link in the description of Odd Ones Out tutorial because that's pretty much everything that I use, except my mic is different. I have a Yeti Pro. Along with that, my tablets that I use is an Intuos 4 and a large size. And I have a small little Intuos that's like travel size. I'm not entirely sure what the number is. I don't have it on me at the moment. The small one's about $140 Canadian, so in America it should be much cheaper. And then the big one, well, that was like $600. So, but I saved my butt off for that one. That was years ago. That was when I was in high school. So that one's still going strong. Second question. Why did you choose to become an artist / big nerd? Okay, so I've been drawing my entire life, since I was a little baby. And I was always the kid in school where if there was a project where you needed to draw something, I would always be the most popular kid in school for that. So everybody would do the writing and the boring parts while I would just draw. And that was great. I loved that. So I've been just drawing forever, but to become an artist, like a professional one, that didn't really dawn on me until like grade 11. So 16, 17. For a while, I'd been trying to get better as an artist, you know, drawing all the time and really trying to learn how structure works with proportions and color and all these things. And then for a long time, my career choice was singing. Don't ever ask me to sing, please. It's definitely like, what was I thinking? I grew up in a family where my dad was a musician and my mom's a writer. So to be artsy and creative was definitely a thing in our family. So, which ties into being a nerd, because both my parents are huge into Star Trek and Lord of the Rings, and like, we just, at the dinner table, we would always talk about that stuff. Pop culture, movies. We were really into, well, we still are really into historical literature, like Shakespeare and, you know, Milton and all that stuff. So it was definitely like, to be in that culture was very easy for me. My friends at school were definitely the kids that were, I guess, nerds. I don't know how to, I don't label it as much, but it was, we were the kids who didn't party. We were the kids who had land parties and, you know, D&D and board games and laser tag. That doesn't mean you're a nerd, but yeah, it was just naturally it all kind of came together. And I started D&D when I was in grade 10, 11. So from there on out, you know, it's all downhill from there. So yeah, that's pretty much how it all happened. Okay, so question number three, how can I and other aspiring YouTube animators gather the courage to start posting videos? Well, when I read this, okay, first I wanted to give this person a hug. I'm like, oh, it's okay. It's okay. You can definitely, it's tough. It's tough because you work so hard on something and then to put it out can be really scary. And I think my advice for people who put out content would be just to accept that not everybody's gonna like it. You know, you can have the most amazing animation, the most amazing joke or something like that, and everybody will just hate, like some people will just hate on it. It's just in their blood. They have a lot of other things going on in their lives, so, you know, they can take it out on you or or anything. So really, you just need to accept that not everybody's gonna like your stuff, and that's okay. You should really just, you should be doing this for yourself, and you should really be doing it to make something that you feel proud of. Another piece of advice I would say is accept that it won't be perfect. It'll never be perfect. It'll be perfect for the time that you made it. So at the time, this is the best I can do. And to accept that. Just put it out there, and you never know what'll happen. You'll always grow, you'll always get better. So just keep at it, and you'll definitely get there. Just the hardest part is to start. And when you start, you have to accept that it's not going to be perfect, and to forgive yourself for making mistakes. Like, it's okay. You're growing. You're a person. You're human. So just really think of it like that, okay? I hope that helps a little bit. What's your favorite class and race to play in D&D? Okay, so I've been... I have a lot of characters, I have a lot of classes I played. For a long time, I played rogue a lot, and fighters. I really liked the close combat aspect of playing D&D, of just like getting in there and taking out your foe. But recently, in the past 2-3 years, I've been playing sorcerers, and I've really come to love that. I really love the creative aspect of sorcerers, you know, going through your spell list and, coming up with really cool solutions to things. I've really come to love sorcerers, so that's definitely on my top of the list. But I'm always trying different classes. I'm always trying different, you know, ways to fight. So, yeah, for class, it's sorcerer. For race, my favorite race is drows. I love drows. I love their backstory with the Underdark and all that stuff. I love that stuff. I've only played about 2 drows, so I really try to, you know, try different races. I mean, Sips is definitely a homebrew race. I try a lot of homebrew stuff. I'm a big fan of homebrew, to be honest. Not that I don't love, you know, D&D's books and stuff like that either, but I love the creative aspect. I love when people make their own stuff and then like, hey, you should try this out too. And it's like, oh my God, this is so awesome. And then you make up your own stuff and it builds and builds and builds. And I love that part about D&D. Okay, next question. Is Dingo your real name? No, it's not my real name. It's a nickname I got in college because... So the little origin story of Dingo is that I went to art college, and we had our first day where we meet everybody, and one of the people in the class had the exact same name as me, like the exact same first name. And I'm not gonna hide it. My first name is Jenna, and so we both had Jenna as the name, and she came up to me and she's like, "Oh, you have the same name as me." And I'm like, yeah, that might be a problem, because if people in the class, you know, say Jenna, it's like everybody, like we both turn. And so that would just, it would make it so frustrating. So she was just like, what's your last name? And I said my last name, and she's like, oh, okay, that reminds me of Dingo. And it's like, okay, cool. So your nickname is Dingo now. And it's like, okay, great. And then it just kind of stuck. And it was funny because in our class, when we started to introduce ourselves as these nicknames, there was a guy in our class who just thought we were insane. We thought, like, who the heck are these girls? So until we explained that we both had the same name, he's like, oh, okay, I get it. But it was funny. And then it kind of stuck. Because I'm still friends with her, and so all my friends refer to me as Dingo, and every time I'm with her and we introduce ourselves, we do it by our nicknames, because it's just easier for us to differentiate each other so that we aren't constantly, you know, misinterpreting conversations and all these things. So it was definitely like we needed to nail this down right when we met each other. Okay, so next question. Can you add color to your animations? No, Next question. No, I'm just kidding. No, I'm not adding color because it takes twice as long and I like to cut as many corners as possible. This channel is supposed to be very, very, in a way, lazy, but also, like, I want to get out my stories and get out the content I want, and color is going to slow me down. So unfortunately, that's just not going to happen. As much as I love color and I love the look of the animations with color, it's just too much work for what I get out of it, where I can still tell my story without color. So that's what I'm doing with this. Okay, so next question. Where did you get the name Electric Bunny Comics / Dingo Doodles? Okay, so the origin of Electric Bunny Comics is kind of, I made the logo before I kind of figured out what the name was. I wanted it, I thought it was cool. It was just like, it's an outlet and it has bunny ears and it's got the electric bolt, and I thought it was really cool. And a little bit of background on me is that not only was my mother a writer, she was also a rabbit breeder. So growing up, I had about 50 rabbits in our rabbitry, which is, you know, outside, that I grew up around rabbits and bunnies and, you know, all cute things in my life. So naturally, the rabbit just became my favorite animal. So Electric Bunny Comics just kind of naturally became the thing. And Dingo Doodles, however, you know the origin of Dingo, but the doodles was definitely the idea of, I want this to be casual. I want this channel to be as free-flowing and as casual and as like a doodle in my sketchbook kind of deal. So I really didn't want to have a stress when it came to this channel. This channel is like therapy to me. It's putting out stuff and experimenting and figuring out what I want to do when it comes to storytelling, because I've really noticed that I really love telling stories. So this channel is more kind of just a workshop for me. Okay, so next question. Are you still making comics? Okay, this one's tough for me because I've been going back and forth in my mind for this for a while, where I've been doing Electric Bunny Comics for 5 years. Like, since I started it technically in 2012, like at the end of 2012, but the actual website wasn't put up until early 2013. So I've been doing it for a while, and it gets to the point where you don't know if you have another joke in you, you know? I would do one-off jokes so many so often that I just wonder, do I have another joke? And I don't know. I don't ever want to close it because there's a lot of comics on there, and I still think in my life that I can make up jokes and just like put it out. But right now, Electric Bunny is kind of like an anxiety for me because I feel like whenever I put out a comic, I'm just like, oh God, is it funny? And I'm trying to figure out what I want to do. I don't want to just say, no, I'm not making comics, but I also don't want to say I'm going to be making comics forever. So I'm not entirely sure what I'm going to be doing with this, along with like my Patreon. Like, I have no idea what to do with it, you guys. Like, I am trying to figure that out right now, and I will figure it out. I just need time to to figure it out. So thanks for the question. These are great questions. I got a lot of questions. I'm not gonna answer them all because this is a speed paint and there's only so much I can speed paint. So don't worry if your questions weren't answered in this video, because I have like an archive of what you guys have been asking. So I'll just, if I do this again, I'll just pull up the archive. Also, for anybody who doesn't have me on Twitter and Instagram and Tumblr, I will put links in the description if you want to follow me. It's okay if you don't want to. It's more like, if you guys wanted to ask me anything, you can. I'm not entirely sure if I'll actually answer them on the social media, or if I'll just keep those questions to do another Q&A. I'm not entirely sure what I really want to do with all this stuff, but so thanks for listening in, and I will see you guys later. Okay, bye.